Welcome to Football's Golden Oldies from the Toll House in Lancaster. This is part one of Duncan Edwards' story. Please remember to subscribe and hit the notification button. It's February 21st, 2023. Front page of the Daily Sketch in 1958. 21 dead, 7 Man United players perished in the air crash. If we could go back 65 years to February 21st, 1958, someone would come into this room and say, Duncan Edwards finally succumbed to his injuries in the Reichstag Hospital at 2:15 a.m. His injuries were chronic, kidney damage, a smashed right thigh, broken ribs, collapsed lung and a broken pelvis. The tragedy of losing the Colossus, the jewel in the crown, was devastating to Manchester United and to England. Duncan Edwards, it says so much about him that even now, over 65 years since he died, he's still probably the most talked about player in Manchester United's long and rich history. Who made the Busby Babes? Matt Busby was driving the Manchester United train, but the triumvirate on the photograph were adding coal to the boiler. Bert Wally, Chief Scout Little Joe Armstrong, and the star maker, Jimmy Murphy. Murphy and his team discovered 80% of the young players. Joe Armstrong, who took over the Chief Scout role from Lewis Rocker after World War II, discovered Bobby Charlton, Duncan Edwards, and many, many more. Man United in 2020 employed 60 scouts, and I would wager that none of them have discovered any players like little Joe Armstrong. Looking at three FA Cup youth wins. Man United against Wolverhampton, 52-53. They won the first leg 7-1 and the second leg was 2-2, meaning a 9-3 aggregate win. 53-54, Man United against Wolverhampton Wanderers again, 4-4 and 1-0, so the 5-4 aggregate win. 54-55, Man United against West Bromwich Albion, 4-1 and 3-0, 7-1 aggregate win. 60 years since his death, he's still talked about. In today's world, so-called fans abuse players and clubs on anti-social media, but it wasn't like that in the 1950s. Then we would watch and appreciate the talents of both teams, especially the Busby Babes. Duncan didn't want to know about the high life. He just wanted to go home or to his digs, simply because he lived for the game of football. From the time he lodged at Birch Road, Old Trafford, then Gorse Avenue, Stretford, and finally to Barlow Road, Old Trafford, he had the world at his feet. Stan Matthews remembers, Duncan was an England regular at 18 years old, a complete player who could play any position on the field, with a huge frame, but he possessed the deftest of skills. Young England 1, England 2, before 43,000 fans. Friday, April 30th, 1954, the eve of the FA Cup final, Duncan was selected to play for Young England versus England at Highbury in the curtain raiser for Preston North End versus West Brom on May 1st at Wembley. Young England, Sims, of Wolves, Sillett, Chelsea, Burn, Man United, Adamson, Burnley, Smith, Birmingham, Edwards, Man United, Hooper, West Ham, Quicksall, Sheffield Wednesday, Hines, Leicester City, Violet, Man United, Pilkington, Burnley. And of course, Tom Finney didn't play because he was playing for Preston the next day. Duncan said, The opposing forward line gave us the runaround, and I'll always remember the lineup of Matthews, Mannion, Lawton, Shackleton and Langton. From 1954 to 1969, this fixture was played mainly at Highbury, but switched five times to Stamford Bridge. Tom Finney was playing for North End, obviously the following day, so Bobby Langton was selected in his place. What did Bobby Charlton think of Duncan? I find I think about Duncan a lot. He was more than a great. Sometimes he seemed like a bright light in the sky. A man is a good player or he is not. A few are great and they deserve respect. But Duncan Edwards was the greatest of them all. I've seen all the players who in their time have been labelled the best in the world. Ferenc Puskas, Alfredo Di Stefano, Francisco, Hento, Didi, Pelé, John Charles, George Best, and all the rest, and not one of them has been as good as Big Duncan. The man was incomparable. Sometimes I fear that there is a danger that people will think that we boost his reputation because he's dead. But he was out on his own as a left half and a first division player in every other position. I'm not a person to dramatise things or dispense fulsome praise, but Duncan was the only player ever who made me feel inferior. There was no other player in the world like him then, and there has been nobody to equal him since. Jimmy Murphy always broke down in tears when anyone asked him about Duncan, and that reaction never left him for 31 years until he died in 1989. Cried every day. What did Matt Busby think of Duncan? His death was the single biggest tragedy that has happened to England and Manchester United. He is one of the all-time greats, there's no question about that. I rate Duncan the most complete footballer in Britain, perhaps the world. He was a colossus. We looked at him right from the start, gave up trying to find flaws in his game, and this was Edwards when he was 16 years old. He was gifted in the arts and crafts of the game, and his temperament was perfect. The bigger the occasion, the better he liked it. Other players would be pacing up and down the dressing room, rubbing their legs, doing exercises to pass time, or having a quick cigarette. Duncan would sit there, calm as a rock in a raging sea. He just lived for the game of football. Busby ignored the football authorities. In season 55-56, United were awesome. They won the title by 11 points. Remember, it was 2 points for a win in those days. The Football League secretary, Alan Hardacre, had dissuaded Chelsea from playing in Europe the previous year. But Matt Busby was having none of it and lined up against the cream of Europe. Hardacre never forgot or forgave Man United or Matt Busby. Matt carried that guilt for the rest of his life. They beat Anderlecht 12-0, swept aside Borussia Dortmund and Atletico Bilbao before a semi-final loss, 5-3, to eventual winners Real Madrid. But they were getting ever closer to their ultimate goal, which was to win the European Cup. The great team of 56-57, the Flowers of Manchester. Seven on this photograph would die at Munich. Johnny Berry and Jackie Blanchflower would never play again. And Ray Wood suffered so much, he was sold to Huddersfield after one game. Only Bill Foulkes and Dennis Violet played on. Imagine a team who won the first division, stroke the Premier League, losing 9 or 10 players at the same time. In the back row you can see Bill Foulkes, little Eddie Coleman, Liam Whelan, Ray Wood, Mark Jones, Duncan Edwards. The front row, Johnny Berry, Dennis Violet, Roger Byrne, Tommy Taylor, David Berg. And inset you've got Jackie Blanchflower and Bobby Charlton. new nickname for Duncan, Boom Boom. England versus the world champions West Germany in Berlin in May 1956. For 25 minutes, England were being overrun when Edwards brought the ball out of defence, beat three men and lashed an unstoppable shot from 25 yards into the net. The crowd immediately named him Boom Boom. England then took control and with further goals from Colin Granger and Johnny Haynes ran out comfortable winners by 3-1. He was still only 19 and the crowd, made up of thousands of British soldiers, carried Duncan off at the end. Edwards was quite simply phenomenal. He tackled like a lion, attacked at every opportunity and dominated the entire game. In 56-57, Duncan Edwards played an astonishing 94 games at different levels. So ignore these people who moan about playing two games a week. In the present day, why do we hear managers complaining about too many games? They've absolutely no idea about Edwards playing two seasons games in a single season. February 1st, 1958, the final match in England against Arsenal ended in a 5-4 victory. Notice the black armbands worn because United director George Whittaker was found dead in bed in the London hotel the team was staying in the night before the game. Why were they so great? Could it have been because they were a group of young friends who loved football like all of us in the 1950s? Just like a village team, a band of brothers, but these times will never be repeated. And in the left photograph, you can see him having fun on the training pitch and then travelling from Blackpool to London, where they'd been training at the Norbrett Castle Hotel for a game in 1957. Got Wilf McGuinness, Bill Foulkes, Mark Jones, Eddie Coleman and Ray Wood turning the two of diamonds. Looks like Eddie was expecting an ace. A bright future beckoned the Busby Babes. Duncan was planning to marry Molly Leach. His great mate Eddie Coleman was planning to marry Marge English when he returned from Belgrade. Eddie used to wind up Duncan by dancing with Molly when they all went to the Continental Club or the Spare Wheel. Eddie's Conti Club cap was found in the slush of Munich along with his red and white scarf. Molly Leach, who you can see in the first photograph, was at Duncan's bedside when he died. She married later and had two daughters, and when she died, around 2022, her daughters sold Duncan's items for £40,000. Eddie was a huge Frank Sinatra fan and would sing Pennies from Heaven as a tribute. Eddie was planning to marry Marjorie English when he returned from Belgrade. The night before they flew out for the game, though, Marjorie had been to Eddie's house and Eddie got a taxi for her to go home and said, "I don't want to go tomorrow, Marge." And he repeated the words three or four times as she got into the taxi. Marjorie looked out of the rear window of the taxi and Eddie stayed in the middle of the road watching her leave until he was no more than a tiny speck in the distance. Did Eddie Coleman have a premonition? I have no idea. Another crack at the European Cup. 1957, they reached the quarter-finals by beating Shamrock Rovers and Dukla Prague to set up a tie with Red Star Belgrade. United won at home 2-1 and drew 3-3 in Belgrade to set up a semi-final against Italian champions AC Milan. The next day, disaster struck. The day, February 6, 1958. The day a team died. They had stopped in Munich to refuel on their way home to Manchester. There was snow and slush on the runway as the BEA Elizabethan made its fateful third attempt to take off. The plane never made it. Just 54 seconds after the pilot opened the throttle, the plane hit the perimeter fence, slithered 200 yards across a frozen field. A wing had been torn off and the tail section had broken away, scattering bodies into the snow. Eight Busby Birds would die. Roger Byrne, Tommy Taylor, Mark Jones, David Pegg, Jeff Bent, Eddie Coleman, and Liam Billy Whelan all died. Busby survived, clinging to life in an oxygen tent, twice given the last rites. School children stuck pictures of the players on their classroom walls. Adults prayed for the injured, willing them to pull through. Foremost in their thoughts was Duncan Edwards. He fought, but after 15 days, he died from his terrible injuries. Because he never grew old, he's a constant reminder of how life used to be. A hero frozen in time, forever a flourishing 21, who carried our dreams on his young shoulders. How did anyone survive? A mangled wreck. But how did anyone come away from that? And the second photograph shows Reese being put on the plane that was taking the boys home. The future had looked so bright. Manchester United looked ominously set to equal Huddersfield and Arsenal's achievement of a hat-trick of championships. The heart was ripped out of United, but they still reached the FA Cup final, losing 2-0 to Bolton Wanderers. It was suggested by Real Madrid that the European Cup should be awarded to United as a mark of respect to the great players who perished at Munich. Manchester United turned down this suggestion. Matt Busby and Jimmy Murphy would in due course set about creating a third great team, but they would never match this one. United lost 5-2 to AC Milan in the semi-final of the European Cup. And the photograph shows Spurs against Man City, which Spurs would win 5-1. They paused for a minute's silence on the first Saturday following the crash. The Flowers of Manchester. Go back to November 1957. Wales versus England at Ninian Park, Cardiff. And Jimmy Murphy's talk was about 10 Englishmen. But Jimmy didn't talk about England and Manchester United's left half. Reg Davies, the Newcastle United little inside forward, put up his hand and asked, "What about Edwards, Jimmy?" Murphy's reply tells you all about Duncan. "Reg, just keep out of his way, son. There's nothing I could say that could ever help you. And the first aid crew will have enough work to do without patching you up." Edwards inspired this kind of awe in all those who saw him play in the 5 years between his debut and his premature death. Reg Davies and Duncan exchanged jerseys after this game, and Reg later emigrated to Australia. He came back for a holiday, maybe 40 years later, about 1998, and he donated the signed Duncan Edwards shirt to the United Museum, a class act. First hearse to leave Old Trafford was the Salford lad, Eddie Coleman of 9 Archie Street. The spiritual home of the Busby Babes. 9 Archie Street, the birthplace of Eddie Coleman, on November 1st, 1936. Bobby Charlton spoke eloquently of spending Christmas with the Coleman family, their friends, neighbours and extended family, with jugs of beer supplied from the corner shop. And of course, Coronation Street was based on Archie Street. That's the end of part one of Duncan.